grace and peace of the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Brothers and sisters, on this, the third Sunday of Easter, we gather together to celebrate Christ's victory over death, a victory that transformed what was something unstoppable into something that leads to the divine. And so we ask that we may be able, through the grace of God, to do the same thing in our lives, on our skill. To begin, we ask the Lord for his pardon and peace, that we might worthily celebrate these holy mysteries. Here we are.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice and proclaimed, "You who are Jews, indeed, all of you staying in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to my words. You who are Israelites, hear these words. Jesus the Nazarene was a man commended to you by God, with mighty deeds, wonders, and signs, which God worked through him in your midst, as you yourselves know. This man, delivered up by the set plan and foreknowledge of God, you killed, using lawless men to crucify him. But God raised him up, releasing him from the throes of death, because it was impossible for him to be held by it. For David says of him, 'I saw the Lord ever before me. With him at my right hand, I shall not be disturbed. Therefore, my heart has been glad, and my tongue has exulted. My flesh too will dwell in hope, because you will not abandon my soul to the netherworld, nor will you suffer your Holy One to see corruption. You have made known to me the paths of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence. My brothers, one can confidently say to you about the patriarch David that he died and was buried, and his tomb is in our midst to this day. But since he was a prophet and knew that God had sworn an oath to him that he would set one of his descendants upon his throne, he foresaw and spoke of the resurrection of the Christ, that neither was he abandoned to the netherworld, nor did his flesh see corruption. God raised this Jesus. Of this we are all witnesses. Exalted at the right hand of God, he received the promise of the Holy Spirit from the Father and poured him forth as you see and hear." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Oh,
realizing that you were ransomed from your futile conduct, handed on by your ancestors, not with perishable things like silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a spotless, unblemished lamb. He was known before the foundation of the world, but revealed in the final time for you, who through him believe in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord.
That very day, the first day of the week, two of the disciples of Jesus were going to a village 7 miles from Jerusalem called Emmaus, and they were conversing about all the things that had occurred. And it happened that while they were conversing and debating, Jesus himself drew near and walked with them, but their eyes were prevented from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing as you walk along?" They stopped, looking downcast. One of them, Cleopas, said to him in reply, "Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know of the things that have taken place there in these days?" And he said in reply to them, "What sort of things?" They said, "The things that happened to Jesus the Nazarene, who was a prophet mighty in word and deed, before God and all the people. How our chief priests and rulers both handed him over to a sentence of death and crucified him. But we were hoping that he would be the one to redeem Israel. And besides all this, it is now the third day since this took place. Some women from our group, however, have astounded us. They were at the tomb early in the morning and did not find his body. They came back and reported that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who announced that he was alive. Then some of those with us went to the tomb and found things just as the women had described, but him they did not see. And he said to them, 'Oh, how foolish you are, how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets spoke. Was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory?' Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them what referred to him in all the scriptures. As they approached the village to which they were going, he gave the impression that he was going on farther. But they urged him, saying, 'Stay with us, for it is nearly evening and the day is almost over.' So he went in to stay with them. And it happened that, while he was with them at table, he took bread, said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to them. said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he spoke to us on the way and opened the scriptures to us?" So they set out at once and returned to Jerusalem, where they found gathered together the 11 and those with them who were saying, "The Lord has truly been raised and has appeared to Simon." Then the two recounted what had taken place on the way and how he was made known to them in the breaking of the bread. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
We know that there is more to the Eucharist, receiving the body and blood of Christ, then forming two lines and having up the main eye. We know that there's more to the Eucharist than physically receiving the body and blood of Christ, important as that is. We know that there has to be an openness. We know that there has to be a spiritual awareness, a reception as well. Otherwise, the great gift that is Christ is outside the doors of our hearts. We understand it is not enough to physically receive the body and blood of Christ day after day, week after week, all the while growing less fervent in our desire for God, and all the while being less willing to take risks that are necessary, risks of word and deed for the gospel. For us, especially in this time, the physical life of the Eucharist is easier to see. A beloved friend is no longer with us, and so we cry out in disbelief, sometimes in pain. God easily sees the lack of spiritual openness, even if we don't. And so also, a lack of Eucharist. A lack of Eucharist that is just as painful as the physical lack of Eucharist to a God who loves his people. A God who continues to offer himself for his people. A God who knows the lack presence of the beloved, and this time grows, whose heart grows, whose spirit has grown weak. And we all know that an important way in which God and all those who follow God, all those in communion with God, an important way to handle this pain is through compassion, through suffering with the other, which is what compassion means. Let us not be quick to forget the lessons of divine mercy last Sunday. Let us not be quick to forget the lessons of the Triduum, where the Son of God, who is divine and himself, come among us to share our joys and share our sorrows. He suffered in a world filled with sin, and he suffered as others condemned him and as others crucified him. He died because of sin, something that we understand. Christ suffered with us. Christ was compassionate. In this pandemic-driven life of the Eucharist, it might be an opportunity for us to suffer with those who are spiritually closed to the Eucharist. We, and as a parish, and we, as a church, lack a complete Eucharist physically, and we can use that hurt to connect up with those who are spiritually closed, those who have turned inward, those who, through a variety of reasons, have isolated themselves from the living Lord in the Both of us lack our complete Eucharist, and we share in something of God's response to it, his continuing compassion. And so, in a strange sense, we come together in a type of communion. If we could figure out a way to avoid COVID-19 and gather together as a living community around the altar of God as is normal, then we would do so. This is a different event. We can choose to live it in communion with the spiritually close, in communion with the compassionate God, or we can not. In this weekend's gospel, two disciples came across someone who, and appearances, and against all common sense, and against all credulity, didn't know what had happened to this Jesus of Nazareth in Jerusalem. And rather than shake their heads and move on, these two disciples tried to respond. They had mercy, they had some sense of compassion, and they tried to express to the stranger who it was that had suffered and died, and who it was that was a subject of those unusual words found in the tomb, and Christ had risen again. And the Lord worked with that openness, that compassion, and that mercy. And the Lord began to tell them about the scriptures, about how what had happened was the fulfillment of the scriptures. And the disciples, as he was saying, knew that their hearts were afire, knew that their souls burned within them. They were open. They were open spiritually. And they recognized Christ. And he took the bread, said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to them. They understood Christ in the Eucharist in a much better sense, through their compassion, through the scriptures, through the Word. This world is suffering from all kinds of sin and darkness, and it continues to do so. It should be no surprise for us that sooner or later this darkness will act against the sacraments. It should be no surprise to us that 2 years ago, during another pandemic, Eucharist was something hard to celebrate. It should be no surprise to us that centuries before that, in places as diverse as England and Japan, it was impossible to go to events because of differences of government and opinion. It shouldn't be a surprise to us that in the first 3 centuries of the Church's existence, sometimes it was possible to go to events and sometimes it wasn't. And so, if the physical aspect is missing, we turn in compassion. We turn in compassion for those who can't receive, for those who are stuck in heart and closed. And we let that compassion prepare us through the other sacraments, especially confession, so as to be open. Like the two disciples, in the words we heard today.
who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess and baptism
for the forgiveness of sins. I look forward to the resurrection
of the dead, the life of the world to come.
Amen. In confidence, we pray to the Lord. In confidence, we pray to the one who conquers sin and death.
With complete faith in God, we join together in the presence of the Father to offer these petitions. This Mass is offered for Louis Tan for his healing and for the repose of the souls of David Zudis, Alfred Jenkins, Jim Gibbons, Francisco and Michelle Nicole, and Daniel Joseph E. Villanueva. For these intentions, let us continue to pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the Church throughout the world, may Jesus, our head, grant us reconciliation and unity. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For war torn nations, may there be peace in every place experiencing violence and war. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have fallen ill and those who have died from the coronavirus pandemic, as well as those charged with protecting the health and safety of others, and those tending to the sick and seeking a cure, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all unborn children, better love for them may keep them safe until the joyous day of their birth. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our men and women in uniform, Lord, protect them in their time of need and sustain their families in these uncertain times. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the full recovery of a Sterling Court resident who tested positive for COVID-19, and that the virus not spread further within the Sterling Court community, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our faithful departed, including Patrick Gibbons, for whom Our Lady of Grace candle burns this week, may he, through Our Lady's faithful intercession, now rejoice with the angels and saints for all eternity in God's heavenly kingdom. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our personal petitions, let us pause in silence. For all of these, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Good and gracious God, you have called us, and we walk in your ways. Free us from sin and death. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you.
sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Father Almighty.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all his holy church.
Receive, O Lord, we pray, these offerings of your exalted church, and as you have given our cause for such great gladness, grant also that the gifts we bring may bear fruit in perpetual happiness, through Christ our Lord. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, by this time above all to love you yet and more gloriously, when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. For with the old order destroyed, a universe cast down is renewed, and integrity of life is restored through us in Christ. Therefore, overcome with blissful joy, every land, every people exalts in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. So that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. Giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is a chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. Especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint George and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm the faith and charity of your pilgrim church on earth with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Oscar, our Bishop, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you, and your compassionate, merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, for whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Give us this
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our hands. Led by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress. As we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give to you. Look not in our sins, but in the faith of your church. Graciously grant your peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever. Amen.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter into my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you. Let us pray. Look with kindness upon your people, O Lord, and grant, we pray, that those who are pleased to renew by eternal mysteries may attain in their flesh the incorruptible glory of the resurrection. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please keep each other in your prayers. Each day that passes is one day closer to the end of this pandemic. And so, look forward to the time when we can all be together around the altar of the Lord. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless you, Father, Son,